need a few minutes, but then I'm going to ask for the Keith and the praise team. I'd like to end with that song. That's good.
Yeah.
Sweet presence in the house, but I felt it from the beginning, you know? I just felt calm.
Hallelujah.
You know?
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
You know, so many times you just want to do something for God, but sometimes God just wants to give you something. You know, it's calm. So I want you to enjoy the presence of the Lord today. I want you to know His love and His peace. I want you to know His rest during this season. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
And I pray even as you leave the doors today, I pray by the mercies of God that this peace would remain abide. Amen?
Yes.
Amen. I'm going to share a few moments, and it's in regard to something we've been talking about for the last week or two. And the reference scripture that I have is in Zechariah. And the title of today's service is True Justice. True Justice. And the reference is in Zechariah. And forgive me, but I must start off with a story, because I believe as you hear and think of the story throughout the weeks or months, I believe the story will resound in you and give you a clear picture and illustration of the message today. But the story I'm about to share, many of you have heard 1,000 times over. It's the story of a man who got caught in a flood. And as he was caught in the flood, and he was home and the waters began to rise, he didn't leave when he was supposed to leave, so he went up and he got on his roof. And as he was on his roof, he was praying to God. He said, God, save me from this mayhem, save me. Those words are important, save me. So, you know, you may have heard the story, a rowboat came along, and there was a very kind man in the rowboat and told him, come in the rowboat, I'm here to save you. And the man on the roof said, no, no need to fear. My God will save me. I have prayed and I believe.
Amen.
Next, the water continued to rise to about the roof line. Of course, we know that a man came along in a canoe. The man in the canoe rode up to him, and guess what the two words the man said to the guy on the roof? Come with me, I'm going to save you. The man on the roof said, no need. My God will save me. I prayed and He will save me. The water was just about to overtake him and his house, and you guys who have heard the story before know a helicopter came. And the man in the helicopter dropped down his ladder, and he shouted to the man, get on the ladder, I'm going to
save you.
And you know the man's response by now, no need. My God will save me. You know the end of the story. The helicopter left. The man drowned. He goes to heaven rather disappointed. He has a conversation with the Lord. He said, Lord, I believe that you were going to save me. You know what the Lord said? I sent you a boat, I sent you a canoe, and I sent you a helicopter. In the scriptures that I'm going to share with you today, I want you to see that God is all around us. He is next to you. He is inside of you. And so many times our God hears us and saves us, but we don't acknowledge or recognize Him. And therefore we live a life of woe because we don't know that our God is here. So if you would, I ask Brother Keith if he would help us this morning with the passage. And we're going to read from the book of Zechariah. So I don't, Keith, were you able to get that? Thanks. From the book of Zechariah in the New King James Translation, I'll have to turn the email. Believe it or not, I don't have the New King James Translation. That's okay. I want to read through the first chapter. Let's read it together. We read it on Wednesday. Now in the fourth year of King Darius, it came to pass that the word of the Lord came to Zechariah on the fourth day of the ninth month, Chislev, when the people sent Sherezer with Rebamelech, and his men to the house of God to pray before the Lord and to ask the priests who were in the house of the Lord of hosts and prophets, saying, should I weep in the fifth month and fast as I have done for so many years? Then the word of the Lord of hosts came to me, saying, say to all the people, and the priests, When you fasted and mourned in the fifth and seventh month during those 70 years, this is the Babylonian captivity, did you really fast for me? And I remember, Gina, I remember your voice on Wednesday. You said it again, for me. Are you here, Gina? I remember you saying that, for me. When you eat and when you drink, do you not eat and drink for yourselves? Should you not have obeyed the words which the Lord proclaimed through the former prophets, when Jerusalem and the cities around it were inhabited and prosperous, and the south and the lowland were inhabited? Disobedience, what does it say?
Resulted
in captivity. Thank you. Then the word of the Lord came to Zechariah, saying, thus says the Lord of hosts. What does he say?
Execute true justice.
Show mercy and compassion, everyone,
to his brother.
Look at 10. Do not oppress the widow, or the fatherless, go ahead, the alien, or the poor. But none of you plan evil in his heart, go ahead. But they refused to heed and shrugged their shoulders, and they stopped their ears so that they could not hear. Yes, they made their hearts like flint, refusing to hear the law and the words which the Lord of hosts had sent by his Spirit through the former prophets. Thus great wrath came from the Lord of hosts. Therefore it happened that just as he proclaimed, and they would not hear, so they called out, and I would not listen, says the Lord of hosts. But I scattered them with the whirlwind among all the nations. What does it say? Amen. Thus the land became desolate after them, so that no one passed through or returned, for they made the pleasant land desolate. Is that the end, Keith?
Yes.
Thank you for your help with that. Some of you know the backdrop to this passage. Zechariah was a prophet who spoke during the time when the remnant of Israel returned from Babylonian captivity. Remember, the Israelites were in Babylonian captivity. Do you remember how many years it was?
70
years. 2 years, they came back from captivity 2 years after rebuilding the temple. It took them 4 years to rebuild it, but 2 years after starting to begin to rebuild the temple, these are the words that you hear from Zechariah. And the people say this. The people went to Zechariah and the priests, and they said, should we continue to fast on those days that we have fasted for over the last 70 years? I want you to know that the days of observation that they were referring to were days when they commemorated the burning of Jerusalem. And they commemorated their governor who was killed by Nebuchadnezzar 70 years prior. So for 70 years, in that month and in that day, they would fast and they would pray and they would mourn in commemoration of the burning of Jerusalem and the killing of their governor, and of course going into captivity. So now that Israel had returned from captivity and they were 2 years into rebuilding the temple, they believed their time of mourning had come to an end, and they asked, should we still fast and weep on those days, being that, you know, our captivity has been restored? And isn't it interesting, the response of the Lord through Zechariah? Because the response of the Lord through Zechariah is this. He says, all along, when you fasted and you prayed and you commemorated those days, did you do that for me, or did you do that for you? Were you mourning the loss of God? Or were you mourning your loss? Does anybody know that there may be a difference in that?
Amen.
And I know it rings true with the days that we're living in today, the economy and the state of the nation and the state of the world. You know, a lot of us can look back a year, 2 years, 3 years. I don't know how far you need to look back. And you can mourn the loss of so many things. Are any of you like me, where you mourn the loss of something that you may have lost?
Yes.
Thanks, I had to wait a little extra. Sometimes I think of the things that were lost and you begin to mourn, but then the question is, well, what are you really mourning for? Are you mourning the loss of the things? Or are you mourning the loss of what God mourns for? You see, there's reason that of everything that's going on in our nation and the world. God is bringing us to certain understanding. He wants to show us what we have truly lost. We think we lost money and houses and cars and so many other things. And the Lord says, you don't even know what you lost. And you're mourning for something that you lost when you don't even really see what you lost. And that's why Zechariah says, you don't even hear the words of the former prophets. You have mourned those years, but you've always mourned for the wrong thing. You mourn for your cities that were burned. You mourn for the houses, small and great, that were burned. You mourn for the men that were destroyed. But you were really not mourning for the loss that God experienced. He lost relationship with his people. Right? His people went and served other things. He lost his people. He lost his children. He lost his heart. That's what God lost. And when he says, when you mourn, he says, don't mourn for the physical things that you've lost.
Your microphone.
Bill, you're going to get it. I promise you. And you can stop mourning now. You can look in your life and you can mourn over things that you have lost, but what are you mourning for? Are you mourning for the loss of what God sees that we've lost? Or are we mourning for really ourselves, right? That's what I see here. And you know, I'd like to keep the passage simple as usual. They didn't recognize what was lost, and oh, I love the reference that was given. Because in reference to the losses, the Lord says this, I believe it's capitalized in verse 10. He says, let me tell you the remedy to it all and the answer to it all. We see so many things in life. We experience so many things. But it's amazing how it's narrowed down to verse 10. He says, this is true justice. Keith, do you have that? You don't have to have it. Do you have it? Okay. He says, this is what you've lost. Who has the New King James Version?
I do.
Would you read it nice and loud and clear?
I do indeed.
Okay. Does anybody else? That's all right. Does anybody else have New King James? Go ahead, Brother Michael, nice, loud, and clear. Verse 10.
Do not oppress the widow or the fatherless, the alien or the poor. Let none of you plan evil in his heart against his brother. Go on.
Yeah, read 11.
But they refused to heed, shrugged their shoulders, and stopped their ears so that they could not hear.
And Michael, is verse 10 where it speaks of the widow and the fatherless and the poor?
Yes.
Thank you. Now, how come, in conjunction with all that's going on, what's referenced is that? What's referenced is the dealing with the widow, the fatherless, the poor, and the stranger? Because this is what I see. This is what I see. What brought them into their demise and what brought them into their loss of so many things that we also are experiencing in our nation was this. What was broken was their relationship with each other. Their care for one another. And you know what I have even seen in my world, and you have seen it in your world? In pursuit of what we think life is all about, we forsake everything that God says life is all about. Because God says our lives are about each other. Amen. It's about our relationships one-on-one. It's about the time we spend with one another, to talk to one another, to love one another. And you know, when we don't understand what our true pursuit is, we have forsaken it all. Because sometimes, and we've all experienced this, we have been so overwhelmed with work that we truly didn't have time for relationships. And you know what I see also? We get confused. Because we think that our love is providing something in a relationship rather than yourself. So I'm going to work real hard so I can give you something, but really, all I really wanted was you. So I don't have you, I just have this token of your presence and this token of your love, but I'd rather have you. Do you guys see that?
Amen.
And at the end of the day, you can give our families and you can give yourselves, you can give yourself success and you can give yourself achievement. You can give yourself status. You can give your family a retirement plan. Rich, you can give your family a retirement plan. I don't even work hard. You can give your family the benefits. You can give them, you know, even the heart of it. I want to give my children something that I never had. And you want to give them the car and the house and the this and the that. And we lose, The capacity is there to lose the relationship. Because we're in our pursuit of success and prosperity. You know? And then when all that was lost in the time, they said, they mourned what they lost from year to year. And they said, you don't even know what you lost. You're mourning the loss of the 401k, the retirement, the benefits, the job. You're mourning the loss of all this. But you still don't even know what was lost. And what was lost was relationship. Relationship. This is what I see. And you know, there was even reference there. He said, remember the former prophets. You know, because these contemporary prophets, he wasn't talking about necessarily Jeremiah and Isaiah and Ezekiel. He said, remember the former prophets. The most former prophet was Moses, you know? And the books that he wrote was Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. And you know the first thing that was lost, even in the garden and in Genesis? You know the first thing that was lost? You know the first thing that was lost? Paradise was lost. Well, how was paradise seen? Paradise was seen in so many ways. Man, they didn't lose, you can say they lost a house, but you know they didn't lose a physical house, right? Yeah. They lost a spiritual house, right? Yeah. What did they lose? I'll tell you what they lost. They lost relationship. Yeah. The love relationship that they have, do you see the decay of relationship? That where they love one another and not one another, in two chapters they accused one another and mistrusted one another. Mm-hmm. What was broken was the relationship. That was paradise lost. That was the riches that was lost, each other. The gift that God gave was each other. The gift that God gave to man. Amen? And you go not just too much further, and you look at the first two brothers that ever existed on the planet. God says that a family is a blessing. Brothers are for strength and for honor. And look what happened to the first two brothers. Strife, jealousy, and I hate to say, murder. What was lost? Relationship. In pursuit of what? Self. In pursuit of self. And we can say all self to give, but we lost relationship. And what I see in Zechariah here is the Lord says this. He says that what you lost was each other. He says you're rebuilding my temple and you're getting your houses back. You know that? Have any of you ever bounced back yet from some of the things that you lost? Maybe some of you have, maybe some of you haven't. Maybe some of you think you have no hope. Oh, I'll never get that back again. But they started to bounce back a little bit. Some of you may experience a bounce back. Maybe you might get a new job, Felicia. I don't know. I'm just talking. Rich, you might get a job. Once again, I don't know. I'm just talking. You know. They started to get a new house, a house for God and a house for themselves. And they said, okay, great. We don't have to mourn anymore. And the Lord says, you don't even know what you lost. You didn't lose a house or a job. Because if we think we lost that, we're going to jump into the new job the same way we jumped into the last job. Head first. Oh, okay, I'm getting it all back. What did you lose? What did you lose? If you know what you lost, you know what you're getting back. People. Relationships. Each other. The reason why we didn't breathe. We get so busy with our lives, man. We'll walk people by on the street. We won't even say hello to them. You guys ever get involved with that? You know, somebody wants to have a conversation with you, but you know you're way too busy to talk to somebody, right? Okay, a few of us are the only one. They're on the phone, but get them off the phone as fast as you can. Listen, I got 10 other appointments. I'll talk to you. You need my help? Okay, ready? Go. Okay, got it. And then, you know, we're going to end the conversation like that. Oh, good, holy week. I'll pray for you. I don't have time to talk to you right now. Isn't it amazing? You jump in your car, you go from point A to point B, and you're in such a rush, half of us are speeding, right? So the janitor, the one who doesn't drive, you don't want her. Who agrees with me? I'm agreeing with you for the rest of them, yes. You're in the car holding on for your life. Please slow down. You know, our relationships may not be intact, but you know what's intact? Or what used to be intact? 401k, retirement. Hey, I got a job with benefits. Yeehaw! I'm going to the doctor. I'm sorry, you know what I say. I wish you never got those benefits. You ever been there? You finally get benefits? Great, now you can go to the doctor. I've been there. I was sorry I went to the doctor. Forgive me for the detour, but he told me I had a heart attack. Yes, he did. I think he probably told some of you also. I'm putting out a bunch of medication. So what? I'm returning my health card. I don't want to see the doctors anymore. And I did. I started going. I stopped. I'll have none of that. But it is simple. And there's a few things I want to read to you. Because I don't want you really belabor it. Let me read to you some of the thoughts that I've written down. Our success and prosperity, the wellness of our souls, is not found in the accumulation of things, of getting jobs and careers and benefits and houses and cars, money, real estate, stocks, diversified portfolios, retirement, college funds. But our success and our prosperity is each other.
Amen.
It's each other. Let everything else be lost forever. You've lost nothing. Let us not forsake people and relationships for things that can be obtained to be given to them. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
Our wealth restored will not be found in the return of finances, not in the return of cars, not in the return of houses, although you may get them. Our wealth restored will be found in each other. When we finally realize, listen to me, we desperately need each other.
Amen.
We have been so busy with life thinking, I don't need anybody. I just got to get this job done and I got to get it done right. Throw it away. I will. Some of you will agree with me. I hope most of you will. You can see, well, we've already talked a little bit about that, but I am convinced that we are the body of Christ. I am convinced that the earth is filled with the visible form of the invisible God. Any of you ever yearn to see God? Any of you ever cry out? You don't have to answer me, this can be rhetorical, but you know, maybe sometimes in our own selves, we just want to see God. And sometimes even in that desire to see God, you know, we wait for a day when we will see God. I want to see God. I want to see God. I want to see God. But so many times in our desire to see God, we look past the true visible form of the invisible God to see something that we already have. You know you're the body of Christ, right? Jesus came in the form of flesh and blood to give you a picture of that, to give you an understanding that you are the body of Christ. The invisible God became visible in the form of flesh and blood. Christ is inside of each and every one of you. My hope and my salvation is found inside each and every one of you. When the man was looking for his salvation, he turned away three people because he didn't realize that that was his salvation. He was looking for something yet beyond the person that was right next to him. There's a person sitting next to us. There's a person in our house. There's a person that we pass by every day in quest for, in reach of something that we think we need to get. And we're passing by God all day, every day. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
Yeah. You know, when I think of Jesus Christ, you know, when you think of Jesus Christ, Christ is not the surname of Jesus. I know you know that, but I'd like to make it perfectly clear. Jesus is not his first name and Christ is not his last name. Some of you, that's a revelation. To me, 2 weeks ago, that was a revelation. Someone told me that. I said, oh, I never knew that. That's just to let some of you know. Okay. Christ is not the last name to Jesus. I don't know his surname. Christ is the description of who Jesus is. Does anybody know what Jesus means? You know. Jesus or Joshua, they're interchangeable. You better give me an answer. God saves. Ah, praise Jesus. Jesus means God saves. The man on the roof said, God will save me. Jesus means God saves. Christ tells you how he will save. Christ means the anointed one. Christ is not singular but plural. You are the body of Christ. Christ saves. Or should I say, Jesus saves through the body. Jesus Christ, his salvation will come through a body. His salvation will come through a body. When Jesus Christ appeared on the earth, it showed the salvation of God in a man. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
So much so that they named him Emmanuel, What does Emmanuel mean?
God saves.
God, come on now.
God saves.
Yes. God is with us. Jesus Christ came to the earth. The whole earth proclaimed, starting with the angels and the shepherds and the wise men. They said, Emmanuel, God is with us. Man cried out to God and said, save me, God. God sent himself in the form of man, and he was called the salvation of heaven. But it was a picture. Because you are the body of Christ. Do you know that?
Yeah.
Next week I'll have scriptural proof of that. Where scripture says again and again that you are the body of Christ. You know what that tells me? My salvation is found in the body. This is my salvation. Jesus, God will save me through Christ, through the Anointed One. And who is the Anointed One? I tell you what, the earth is filled with the glory of the Lord. Does anybody believe that one?
Amen.
Man, oh man, and I and you, at times we can walk past our Savior and our salvation all day long, like that silly man on the roof. I walk past you, I walk past you, I walk past you. Because I am looking for God to save me. God, save me. God, hear my prayer. And I walk by my salvation all day, every day. And that's why they said, can we stop mourning and fasting? No! You don't know what you lost yet. You don't know that your salvation is each other. Isn't that beautiful? You don't know that your salvation is each other. I don't know. And we're learning to discover that. Let me read a couple of other things here. Jesus Christ is the salvation that you will find in the many-membered body of Christ. Can I get a witness? Your salvation will not be found in... Oh, this is very good. Because I think so. Listen. So many times we get so busy about working for God, I want to do good things for God, you know. Your salvation will not be found in how much people need you. You have people that need you? Come on now. Does anybody need you? Rich? Of course, your children need you. You know there's people in your life you come across who need you. They need you for physical things, they need you for spiritual things, but I'm going to tell you this, your salvation will not be found in the people that need you. Hear me, everyone, from the preacher to Brother Keith from the sound booth. You ready, Keith? Your salvation will be found in how much you realize you need people. That's where your salvation is. I cannot experience salvation until I realize how much I desperately need you. In a world that's full of our success, you know what we say? In ignorance, I don't need you. Then you'll never be saved. You'll be drowned and talk to Jesus at the end of time and say, I thought you wanted to save me. I sent someone to save you. You said you didn't need me. Your salvation is not found in the people that need you. Your salvation is found when you realize that you need people. Not only do you need them, I don't know, how desperately do you cry out for God? Anybody want to be honest with me? How desperately do you cry out for God? I'll try not to look at most of your eyes. How desperately do you need God? When sometimes you're at your lowest point and you cry, you say, God, do you hear me? God, will you save me? God, when? Anyone ever use that one? God, when? Hopefully you don't use the why, Maria. The when is good, the why, you just, oh, that one's tough. I don't know the why. That is as desperate as we need to be in seeing that our salvation is in each other. God sent us our salvation in each other. And what I find what God is doing in times like this is he's first of all causing us to realize that we need each other. Listen, when I'm successful and I have money, Phil, I don't need you. And I don't need your money, because I want to prove to you I'm good, I got it. But let me tell you what fellas experienced over last year. I emptied this bank account. And I'm not ashamed. Oh, I'm not ashamed. When my house was large and my cupboards were full, Keith, I don't need you. It's interesting, Keith. The email I sent you this week, I said, we need you. Are you self-made? I hope not. Can you do it on your own? No, because you're lost on your own. Do you need everybody around you?
Yes.
As desperately as you need your Savior. Right? But that's what I see God has showed us in the time. We realize what we lost, He showed up. But it's so beautiful. You're looking for God to come and save you, and God is all around you, man. You know what I love? I love, and I told you so often, when Jesus is standing in front of the Pharisees and He tells the Pharisees, He says, you know, you have never seen God, Robert. He said, you have never seen God nor heard His voice. You hear me say this before? He said, Jesus said, you have never seen God or heard His voice. And meanwhile, God's in front of Him talking to Him in an invisible form. But Jesus knew that He didn't recognize Him. Jesus knew that He didn't recognize Him as God. Therefore, He stood in front of them and said, you have never seen God. Meanwhile, God was standing right in front of Him. He said, you never heard His voice. And He's having a conversation with Him. And that's us all day, every day. All day, every day. God save you. He's talking to you. He's looking at you. He might be, excuse me, sitting right next to you. Not the response I was looking for, but we can work with it. We can work with it. Now, I don't know if you're laughing at this one or this one, but God bless you. We don't embarrass you. But that's where our salvation is found. Now I'm going to end with this. You know the silliness. Let me tell you this, man. The silliness. We want to fulfill true justice. So you know what we do to fulfill true justice? I'll tell you what we do. We send money to Haiti. We send food to Africa. We send missionaries. I'm fulfilling true justice. I'm helping the poor, the widow, the fatherless. That's not true justice. Because you still haven't seen the poor. You still haven't seen the widow. You still haven't seen the fatherless. Who are the widows? Who are the fatherless? Who are the strangers? And who are the poor? You ready? I am. I am the widow, and I am alone every time I walk past you looking for my companion. I remain alone and a widow when I walk past you because I'm looking for my God. I'm looking for my companion. I am the widow. I am the fatherless. Every time I look past you to look for my father. Every time I look past you, the gift that God has put inside you to give me some words of a loving father, to give me perhaps the embrace of a loving father, perhaps give me some words of wisdom. Every time I walk past you looking for my father, guess what? I am the fatherless. I am the stranger. I am the stranger. I am the stranger. Every time I look into your eyes and I don't see my friend, and I don't see my brother, and I don't see my God, then I am the stranger because He's right in front of me. And that's why the Lord says, take care of the stranger, take care of the fatherless, it's you. What's the last one? I am poor when I walk past all of the treasures of heaven in pursuit of something that is empty and vain and pointless. I am poor when I walk past my Savior. Anybody want to give me a witness?
Amen.
God bless you all. God bless you all. We will find our salvation in each other. The Lord says this. Love each other. See the God in each other. We're looking for God. I believe God is all around us. We cry out for something we already have. Can I get one more witness?
Amen.
Amen.